Welcome to class. It's good to be teaching to students, to real students again. My name is Michaela Eichmeier. Pronouns are he. This is lecture 14. On our class topics in geometric analysis. And it's the final lecture. So today we are going to finish the solution of the plateau problem after J.C. Douglas. So recall what are we trying to do? We dip a simple closed curve, a wireframe for example, into soap solution. We pull it out. We observe there's a soap film forming. We recognize this surface is not any odd way. It's in fact the surface that is trying to minimize the given boundary with the least amount of area possible. And so what we're trying to do in this class, and mathematics has been trying to do for a rather long time, is to prove that the outcome of this experiment that I guess one way or the other we've all carried out as children, maybe if you're a big child like me, also more recently, then is to prove mathematically that these surfaces form. And what is the setting? So we have just fix a few things. So gamma Rn is a simple closed curve. It's a simple closed curve. It says smooth. A lot could be done assuming only that gamma is really defiable. We are looking. So one thing that is relevant is how to parameterize such curves. So any such curve is the smooth image of a circle. Through a name, whose derivative is nowhere vanishing. So it turns out that for the solution of the plateau problem. It is a good idea to look at parameterizations of such curves that are only continuous, and in fact not even necessarily injective, but weakly monotone. So gamma is to Rn is a weak parameterization. So if you think about it, so it's possible that lowercase gamma is constant along intervals on the circle. Except for that possibility, that's the only way injectivity can fail. So it's the same difference. I guess it's a slightly different category, but it's the difference between strictly increasing and just non-decreasing. So intervals are mapped. So this is what it means to be a weak parameterization. So we have such parameterizations exist for every simple closed curve, in particular for smooth curves. And there was there's an elementary fact that uniform limits. Many times in this course, unless I cut it short. So I'm going to abbreviate it by WP. Okay. So here's our goal. So what we're going to prove today is we're going to prove that there exists a map phi from the closed unit disk to Rn with the following properties, such that when I restrict phi to the boundary circle, then it means gamma is the restriction of phi to the boundary circle. This is spell it out one more time, with parameterization of gamma. Let's stay with smooth and harmonic. And moreover, on the open unit disk, it is weakly conformal. This map is another set of points in D where the differential of phi vanishes is no accumulation. Points in D. So there may be infinitely many such points, but not in D. So in any complex subset of D, there are definitely many. So notice this means that so in particular phi restricted to the open unit disk is an immersion. It's an immersion, or is an immersion, is a conformal immersion. Let's give this set name, maybe V is a vanishing set on D minus V. It's a conformal immersion on D minus V. And in fact, it's a minimal immersion. Why is it? Why does it follow already? So this is something that I made a big fuss about earlier on in class, that for conformal immersions, being a monic and being minimal is the same thing. Why? Because of the Weierstrass lemma. This is the Weierstrass lemma. Okay. So, in the so they statements, statements here. So in fact, we're going to, so, you know, we're talking about minimal immersions. That's not the same thing as being area minimizing, but it's good enough for now, right? You will see from the construction that the way we're going to find this map is by finding, identifying an energy minimizing map that has all of these properties. So energy minimizing maps are always harmonic, right? And if they minimize under reparametrizations, then they are also weakly conformal. We've proven that. So this is how we are going to find it. And so I'm thinking about having another add-on lecture on video where I'll show you how to find such maps that are actually energy area minimizing. But for now, so this is the original solution of the plateau problem. So the Fields Medal winning paper of Jesse Douglas, I believe, it contains more than this, but not in the dimensions that I've just discussed. There's a lot that goes into the proof of this result. So let's discuss the strategy. The strategy of the proof is as follows. Strategy. The strategy of proof is to minimize energy. So that's if you go half times the gradient of phi squared d among all maps. Curly m. Continuous up to the boundary and smooth on the inside. So it turns out, and I wanna, you know, maybe just leave this as an aside. Remember, if you had found a minimizer of this functional, it's not finding a minimizer of such functionals that have a natural invariance is always tricky, right? Because there's not, you know, if you have found a minimizer, that there are always many minimizers that you obtain by reparametrization. So we've already seen energy is not invariant under general reparametrization, but it's invariant under conformal reparametrization. And there are, so we've also discussed this, this is Schwarz's lemma, many fewer diffeomorphisms of the unit disk than there are general diffeomorphisms of the unit disk, but there are still infinitely many. All the Möbius transformations. So, just making the mark here in this connection. So remember, the Möbius transformations, they have this form. So there's the rotation by an angle that you can allow. But so any map of this form where A, so what I want to say is that the limit of A tends to 1, where A is less than 1, of this, mm-hmm.
want in this case that he's then going to want them.
What is it equal to?
1?
It's equal to 1.
Yes, A is 1.
Yeah.
I think you know.
It's equal to 1. So if you right, if you view this as a family of diffeomorphisms, right, you know, it will converge pointwise, you know, to the constant map that puts everything equal to 1 in this limit as A tends to 1. So, so let's call this this map. Let's call this map here psi A of Z. So, in particular, precomposed with psi A for all phi let me say in H1 of the unit is into Rn and phi precomposed with psi A converges to phi, a constant net. You see, this is a, this is still, this this is showing you that even, let me take the proof a little bit further, and later I will refer back to this observation. So our strategy is to minimize energy among all maps that restrict to weak parallel positions of number on the boundary. So now, let's denote by I, capital I, to be the optimum of energy over all such maps. And observe that this optimum is less than good to know, right? Why capital gamma is a smooth curve, so you can always take one smooth function here, smooth up to and including the boundary, and of course you'll have finite energy. So the question of what, you know, when gamma is only rectifiable, can you extend it to a map of finite energy? Yes. With rectifiable curves, you can do that. That's why rectifiability plays a crucial role as a condition. So, the next thing we're going to do is we're going to select three points, P1, P2, and P3, in gamma, fixed and distinct points. And an important claim is now the following. I can't finish this on this board. Yeah, delete over here. It made me so I'm thank you. what we'd like to so you know proof strategy of proof. So we want to find a minimizer of energy in F. So it turns out that the class F is a little bit too large to find this minimizer. So here's an important claim, namely that RF is also equal to the infimum of the energy of moments phi that are from a smaller class F prime, where F prime is the set of all mix phi in F, such that two conditions are satisfied. So first, phi of e to 2 pi I, so these are the cube roots of unity, 2 pi r on 3 times k is equal to p k. This is for all k is equal to 1, 2, 3. And the other condition is the phi is harmonic. So first of all, let's just, so I like my prerequisites. What are we doing here? So what we are doing is we are pinning, I mean this is obviously symbolic, but the Ramius, and I'm not sure my cousin knows, Atlas this is, oh, forgive me. Also my geometry teacher, I'm sure he will not forgive me because there's no way at least the cube roots of unity. So we are pinning the map at these three points, these values we fix, right? This goes to P1. Ah, I'm sorry. Okay. Ugh. This is, I'm sorry, it's not wrong. Even though maybe morally it is. Yeah, I feel better now. So these three values we pin, right, on the curve gamma. So these values we prescribe. Now, if you remember, let's first think about just this class of functions. Why is the claim that the infimum over the class of functions are from curly F that keep these three values pinned? That energy takes the same infimum over this smaller class of functions. Why is that?
Those precompose with a suitable conformer.
Exactly. So energy is invariant under precomposition with conformal diffeomorphisms, and the group of Möbius transformations acts three transitively in this way. So given any three distinct points on the union circle, there's a in order, you can find a conformal diffeomorphism of the unit disk that maps them to the cube roots of unity. And energy is invariant under precomposition of conformal diffeomorphisms. So this is something that you can do and you're not losing anything. So, if you think about it, it's that condition that will handle in the proof. Take care that this doesn't happen. It's that you're pinning these values. So the second question is, why is it enough to only consider maps phi that are harmonic on the inside? Why is that? So a claim, so is it still a claim, right? Why is it enough to only consider MIPS 5 that are harmonic on the area? When I'm looking for the infimum over all possible energies.
Because we know we're looking for something that's could be performance harmonic, and that's being just minimize over that, instead then when we find a minimizer there, we can say that it also minimizes outside.
No.
Right.
So remember, why are we, what is the relation between harmonic MIPS and energy? Just think of, let's think of harmonic functions and the usual derivation energy.
Can they preserve energy?
So, harmonic MIPS minimize energy among all MIPS of the same boundary values. That's the Dirichlet principle. Yeah. So if you give me any MIP phi in here, something that I can do is I can compute its energy, and I can compare that to the energy of the MIP that I obtain by replacing each component of phi by its harmonic extensions to the inside. And by the Dirichlet principle, I certainly obtain something that has no more energy than the original MIP. The boundary values are the same. Is this important that this is here? I need to explain it again. So this is by Dirichlet.
We know that once we find a minimizer, that has to be one that's also in that set, that we can also look for one in there and then deduce that it must be the original one. The chronology might be a bit off, but it's
yes.
The same thing.
No, okay. It's not the same thing, but it's, it's related,
yeah.
Of course.
Yeah.
But, so I think, are we all on this the same page? Okay, so it turns out we can actually find a minimizer in this class. So it's let me show you how. So that there's a subsequence such that the corresponding weak ground metrizations of gamma that you obtain by restricting the maps to the boundary, that there's a uniformly convergent subsequence and the limiting map is gamma. Second, there are phi k smoothly on D. So in every compact subset of D, all the derivatives converge uniformly. In such that phi k converges to phi weakly in H one. So H one being L2 integrable maps with finite energy.
Why is the second convergence doesn't contain the first one?
So smoothly on D, let me say smoothly on compact subsets. Of D. So D is the open unit disk.
So the key difference is, I guess, that on the open disk, derivatives are defined.
It turns out the boundary regularity is a big problem. So something that this convergence does not preclude is that the derivative of phi k explodes near the boundary. So there could be a sequence of points z k such that the derivative of phi k at z k tends to infinity, but only if z k converges to the boundary.
I think the point is more that if phi can curve to phi uniformly in D bar, and we also say that phi is in F prime, at that point, the first bullet point that the boundary functions converge uniformly should also follow.
No.
Why not?
The smooth thing means the limit. Phi is smooth.
Phi is not necessarily smooth up to the boundary, it's only continuous up to and including the boundary. So when I say up to, I mean up to and including the boundary.
I think smooth convergence means that phi k and all its derivatives converge to phi and the respective derivative. This is what smooth convergence means.
Is this okay? Okay, so why does phi k converge to phi? Okay, so this is let's see, I don't want to make any more bold claims. Let's prove this claim. So let me first explain how this statement here follows from this statement, right, from this claim. So the maps phi k, so these maps phi k are continuous up to the boundary, smooth on the inside, where they are also harmonic. Harmonic functions satisfy the maximum principle. So, their largest and the smallest value is assumed on the boundary. So, because the Laplace equation is a linear equation, that implies that when you have boundary values that are converging, then the harmonic functions are also converging uniformly. I'm sorry, parameters are converging uniformly, then the functions themselves are converging uniformly. This is a consequence of the maximum principle. Now, also, I mean, why? This also proves why there is a continuous limit of the harmonic functions that also follows from the maximum principle. But because there are harmonic functions, you have interior estimates. If you remember, harmonic functions on bounded, if you have families of harmonic functions with any, you know, that are bounded on bounded subsets, then their derivatives are also converging. They're uniform bounds on derivatives of any order on these compact subsets. So the fact that such a map phi exists is a so. This is trivial by a non-trivial fact, and it's called Hilbert space theory. So this is trivial by functional analysis. But in Hilbert space, when you have any bounded sequence is a weakly convergent subsequence. I don't even know what that is, but it's trivial if you look at it the right way. So, and these two are these are the maximum principle.
So just to check, we know that it's in not just H dot one, but H one also. And we know the convergence is all in there because the maximum principle gives us that we're bounded uniformly for the sequence, so the L two norm is also bounded, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, that's the one gap I hadn't had yet.
Okay. So. The key statement is this one. And this will follow from the Courant-Lebesgue lemma and the three-point condition. So let's try this. Family is equibounded. Why? Because they all parameterize gamma. This is too short. So they are clearly equally bounded. Once we show that they are equally continuous, the claim follows from the Mozilla's. Okay. So why are they equally continuous? So to see this. Let epsilon bigger than zero be given, and let's assume that epsilon is smaller than long gamma between two points P and Q is less than epsilon if the Euclidean distance is less than delta. So this is important, right? You can have curves that come very close to themselves, right? So, you know, the distance gamma pq, this is the chord arc distance, pq gamma, right? So the distance from p to q along gamma is the smaller of this arc and of that arc, whichever is the smaller. If you want, it's a geodesic distance on the curve, but it's, so this follows from continuity. This follows from the fact that your curve gamma, with its geodesic distance, is homeomorphic to the circle. But just to recognize, right, that this is really testing you on some point. So P and Q might be close, might be Euclidean close, but surprisingly far apart along gamma. But, you know. So then, I want to let eta in 0, 1 be such that you can take it to the I plus 1. Okay, so gamma at this point is a given positive number, right? N is a known number. So I guess you could just take phi 1 because I said they converge from above. It doesn't matter. So by, you know, taking eta sufficiently small, I can certainly arrange this. Yeah. arbitrary point on the limit subcourse by the current victim, the current living lemma exists. Circle of radius R and theta and W intersects the circle of the unit circle. So the picture is the current Weglemma says exactly that I can choose this radius in that range such that the square of this distance here is less than or equal to the energy of phi in the annulus radius eta in a radius eta lower radius square root of eta centered at W and intersected with the unit disk of
comments, I think you want 5k because I overused it. And probably m should be a supreme number. So the inf would be the.
Yes,
yeah.
Thank you. No vote. So this R okay, so okay, maybe get this. Thank you for the observation. I don't want to carry the index key. So but now what does this mean? So this means so in particular the distance on gamma between phi k w1 and phi k w2, which then also depend on k, but this is less than Euclidean distance between the two image points is less than delta, so the distance along the curve is less than epsilon. By the three-point condition, JavaScript the arc, or rather the segment is intersected, the discal radius R and center the W is mapped to the short arc in gamma. So okay. So this could be phi of W1, this could be phi of W2. And so I know that the distance between these two points along gamma is less than epsilon. So what I don't know is, so imagine phi was an embedding, forget about the monotone, the weak monotonicity for a moment. What I don't know is, does this segment here, is it mapped to this part of the curve? Or is this segment, which is short here, mapped to the other part of the curve? What I claim is that using the three-point condition, it follows that this segment here is mapped to this short arc of length less than epsilon along the curve. So why is this? So here's P0. So here are my cube roots of unity. What the distance between two such I just want to see how did I see it in the right order. So if this were mapped, if this segment here were mapped to the long arc, along the long arc, okay, I'm sorry, to the short arc. I'm sorry. So if this segment here, this connected set, were mapped here, then all these cube roots of unity. So there is something that I said at the very beginning, right? Epsilon, epsilon is less. Thank you. Epsilon is less than these distances. So this could not happen, right? Because so I came on the heat. So let me return to the condition. I hope Martin can edit this away. The 3-point condition, the second condition is mapped to the short arc. So I wonder, where does this go? Does this go here or does it go there? So I know this, so it's one or the other. It's either short or long, that we already know. Suppose this is mapped to the long arc. Along gamma. So notice that when I have, so I'm putting this here for stretch work, of course the distance between two points P and Q is always less than or equal the distance along gamma. So if I have, I mean, there are 3 Q roots of unity here. Let's just focus on 2, right? Their distance is bigger than epsilon. The Euclidean distance is bigger than epsilon. So their distance along the curve is also bigger than epsilon. So this cannot happen. So this means this segment here cannot be mapped to the short curve connecting P of W1 and P of W2. So, and the point is that you can never, and these balls that I'm drawing here, just because their radius always lies between, is no bigger than 1, there will always be, you can contain at most 1 cube root of unity in that ball. So, this is not given in this picture, but imagine here is my note giving this now. So the important thing is that you understand and that you are able to explain. So this short segment here connecting W1 and W2 in this configuration can contain at most 1 cube root of unity. It can contain at most 1 cube root of unity. That means that the remaining segment contains 2 cube roots of unity. So that remaining segment cannot be mapped onto a short curve along gamma. It must be mapped onto the long curve along. This means this segment here, right? Because you meet the whole curve, you map onto the whole curve. This short segment here also goes, is mapped to the short curve connecting P and phi of W1 and phi of W2 in all gamma. But that's it. So you can repeat this. If you think about the argument R, so this is check. So
what is of phi or phi k?
Phi k. image of S intersected S eta R is equicontinuity on the nose.
D beta point.
But the R could still be K dependent, so it sort of doesn't. Oh no, D eta I, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So eta is a lower bound to all over the other. Clearly, it's really clear gamma and k are equibounded. Uniformly on the whole disk. By interior estimates, we see that this function phi is smooth on the inside, in fact harmonic, and that the convergence is smooth on compact subsets of the unit disk. And then by general Hilbert space theory, we have that phi k converges to phi in each one. So notice, I guess, let's just check, is phi in F in F, this phi that we have found, is it really in the class? Well, it's of the right make, so it's in fact smooth on the inside, continuous up to and including the boundary, it's harmonic on the inside, and does it satisfy the three-point condition? Yes, because the boundary values converge uniformly. So, now, almost done. So, chase, which is equal to I. This is valid convergence. I guess you can also get it from the smooth convergence. That's kind of clear. So what we've seen before, right? It is possible, you know, that you have a strict, you know, that this drops, right? It's possible to take phi chi's, you know, phi reparametrize it so it converges to a constant net. And so you can actually don't want to get carried away. So this means phi is in F prime, it follows that phi of phi is equal to phi. Can't be strictly less. Maybe single convergence. This is a name, this is the lower semi continuity. Of norm under our minimizer of energy. It's a weak parametrization of the boundary. Yeah. So the next claim is that phi restricted to B is weakly conformal. This follows since really by construction the energy of phi is less than or equal to the energy of any reparametrization of psi any diffeomorphism. That's it. Every time I remember, this is I. This is the least energy any net that parametrizes gamma on the boundary can have, right? And you know, pre-composing with a diffeomorphism, we certainly continue to parametrize weakly gamma on the boundary. So, but from this weak conformality follows, we've proven this. So by a previous lemma, so. Previous lemma, previously proven last time, phi to be restricted conformal. V, which I recall, is the set of all points in D such that the differential of phi vanishes at the now we, it's actually quite nice because now we just get to piece things together. So this is a property that that harmonic functions, that holomorphic functions have. So means every component is a holomorphic function. And the zeros of that holomorphic function are exactly the points where the differential of phi vanishes. Now so all three of them simultaneously. Complex analysis. To extend continuously to a map that parameterizes gamma, the constant is gamma. Everything promised. There's one more property that I have time to show you. The proof of this is a nice ergon, like complex analysis.
baiting.
She's having baiting. I am magic. If that's the property that is still missing. But because weak parametrizations, they might be constant on segments. To see this, assume not, then gamma is constant along some segment. This is how weak parametrizations fail to be injected, is by being constant on beyond the point along a segment, along a segment. And so so then the thing that you can do so is to Schwarz reflection. Remember when you have a holomorphic map on you I like best to state the Schwarz reflection principle on a half space. If you have a holomorphic function on a disk intersected the half space that has constant boundary values, so it vanishes on the boundary, then the odd reflection is actually a holomorphic function. So you need this constant boundary values, for this odd reflection to even be, to even stand there. It doesn't make sense otherwise. But if it does, then it's an easy way to extend a holomorphic function simply by odd reflection. And okay. So you can also do this on a circle. Right, because the upper half space and the circle are biholomorphic. There's nothing that's stopping you from doing this. So what you can do is, if you have phis, okay, I'm sorry, this is also important, on Schwarz reflection, you only need continuity up to the boundary. You don't need to know it extends to a holomorphic function. To start with, that's already part of it, the consequence of the of Schwarz reflection. When you have so phi, we already know, is harmonic and it's weakly conformal. So when it's harmonic, right, you can conjugate it to a holomorphic function. You can also do Schwarz reflection just on the level of harmonic functions. Yeah, but if it has constant boundary values, every component is constant along a segment, you can extend, so this is not an exact, you can extend, you can find a small disk across, intersecting this segment, such that you can take your original function phi and extend it to a harmonic function, a real part of a holomorphic function, a holomorphic map, across that segment. And if you think about the way, there's a unique economical way of doing this. There's only one way of doing it. And that map will continue to be weakly conformal on this larger domain. particular, I mean, when you are, you know, in the half space picture, it's clear that these odd reflections won't change being weakly conformal. So okay, this is okay. So depending on how long ago you thought about you first thought about Schwarz reflection, you know, the more or less complete this explanation is. So if the boundary values are constant along a segment, you can take phi and you can extend it on a small disk across that boundary to a weakly conformal harmonic map. And this weakly conformal harmonic map is constant along the segment, of course. This is also how it's been constructed. So these directional derivatives along the segment vanish. But because it's weakly conformal, if the derivatives vanish in one direction, they vanish in all directions. So actually you have that the whole gradient of phi vanishes along this segment. And if you think again about what this means for harmonic functions, it means that the function actually vanishes identically. Or is constant. Is constant. So what you get is that this map phi is constant on this disk. It means it's constant on part of the original domain, and because it's a, you know, you can use either complex analysis or, you know, analyticity of harmonic functions that implies that phi was constant to start with, and that can't happen. So let me capture this in a few keywords or try to along a segment. So by Schwarz reflection, or rather using Schwarz reflection, phi extends to a harmonic weakly conformal map across part of the segment of this segment. By weak conformality, always the last few minutes. So by weak conformality, the gradient of this extension vanishes along the segment, by, you know, complex analysis, the extension is constant. Analysis, phi is constant. This is a contradiction. Okay. So, right. You find references to the literature in the notes that I've also posted to the Moodle course. So that, you know, in the notes proceed a bit differently from how I presented things in class. But you know, it fits together well. There are, you know, so this is, you know, this is the beginning of minimal surface theory in many ways. People have shown that there's so much, you know, follow up, but you know, if in the setting that we are discussing, not only will these maps be continuous up to the boundary, they will in fact be smooth up to the boundary. If gamma is a CK alpha curve, then the functions will be CK alpha. When the alien dimension is 3, this is important, then you know, the gradient of phi will not vanish anywhere. It will not have any vanishing points. It will be smooth up to and including the boundary in the I'm sorry, you know, it will be an immersion. You know, if everything is smooth, it will be an immersion up to and including the boundary. So these are all, you know, big steps in the development of minimal surface theory and with it the theory of geometric partial differential equations. So there are, I've tried to favor this class also historically. For the exam, so two of you, Misha and David. So, question: who will take the exam?
Mm-hmm.
Is yeah, with the PhD students, I'm never sure how much is great. So, what I'm going to do is with Misha, I'm going to maybe talk now briefly if you still have time. And so, actually, let me finish class. So let's talk about the exams secretly.